Good morning, everyone. I'm Elizabeth Hewlett, Chair of the Prince George's County Planning Board, and the January 13th, 2022 Planning Board meeting is now in session. This is our 74th virtual meeting since the pandemic commenced in March of 2020. I'm going to take a moment to remind everyone of our procedures during these virtual hearings. Speaker pre-registration and pre-submission of comments and exhibits is required. All participants must pre-register, and all materials or exhibits, if any, must be submitted by 12 noon on the Tuesday before the Planning Board meeting, as shown on the screen, as announced in every single weekly meeting, public meeting, posted on our website, and clearly stated in bold red on our published weekly Planning Board agenda. So people should know by now. Registered speakers and presenters may join the meeting with the link provided via email from the Planning Board office, or may listen or participate by phone utilizing the call-in number provided via the email. And of course, the public may continue to watch Planning Board meetings streamed live, or if you wish to become a person of record, which you may sign up on our online web form, please see the cursor and note the screen for instructions. As always, we commence our hearings with a moment of silence in honor of the individuals and loved ones throughout our community and nation who passed away since our last meeting of January 6, 2022. We want to remember within our commission family, Marguerite Spate. Marguerite Spate worked with the Maryland National Capital Park and Planning Commission's Department of Parks and Recreation for over 20 years and retired in 2017. She was a gem to the commission, and we want to remember her and remember her family in our thoughts and prayers. Andrea Williams, who is the wife of Dale Williams. Dale works at our executive office building, has been there for many, many years, and is devastated to lose his wife and life partner. So we want to remember the families in our thoughts and prayers. Within Prince George's County, we want to remember Henry T., known as Hank Arrington, who was the former mayor of Seat Pleasant and a commissioner on the Washington Suburban Sanitary Commission, WSSC. He's the father of Hank Arrington Jr. and also of Mike Arrington, a former delegate in Prince George's County. We want to remember the countless people who have succumbed to the pandemic. This is really, really bad because the numbers have escalated dramatically. Worldwide, we have closing in on 318 million cases, over 5.5 million deaths, 5.5 million deaths. In the state of Maryland, over 861,000 cases and over 12,500 deaths just in the state alone. This is a huge problem. You know you have to take care of yourself. You know what you have to do to keep yourself and your loved ones safe. So we want to remember the victims of the Bronx apartment fire on Sunday, the 17 victims as young as 2-year-old who have died and some who were hospitalized. Iconic, brilliant actor, film director, and diplomat, civil rights activist, Sidney Poitier. His best-known films explored racial tensions during the civil rights movement. He was the first African-American man and the first Bohemian to win an Academy Award for Best Actor for his role in Lilies of the Field. He starred in Porgy and Bess, A Raisin in the Sun, To Sir with Love, Guess Who's Coming to Dinner, and of course, In the Heat of the Night. He was awarded the Presidential Medal of Freedom, and we will always call you, if not after Sidney Poitier, Sidney, we will call you Mr. Tibbs. Bob Saget, age 65, comedian who starred as the widowed father of three young daughters in the TV sitcom Full House and served as a host of America's Funniest Home Videos, only age 65. Calvin Simon, age 79, he was one of the founding members of Parliament Funkadelic with George Clinton. Dwayne Hickman, age 87, the actor who portrayed Dobie Gillis in the TV sitcom and appeared on the Bob Cummings Show in the 50s and 60s. He also played a brilliant comedic role in the film Cat Ballou, one of my favorites from way back. Marilyn Bergman, Now, Mr. Gibbs, I'm going to turn to you about Dwayne Hickman and Dobie Gillis. Marilyn Bergman, age 93, the Oscar and Grammy winning lyricist who collaborated with her husband to write songs for TV, films, and stage productions, and for legendary artists like Frank Sinatra and Dean Martin. She was known for writing The Way We Were, The Windmills of Your Mind, and You Don't Bring Me Flowers. Lawrence Brooks died at the tender age of 112 years young. He was the oldest living U.S. veteran of World War II. There was a huge drive-by party for his 112th birthday this past September of 2021. Just amazing. James Mtume, the jazz and R&B musician, songwriter, producer, best known for his hits Juicy Fruit, You and You, Me, and He. Michael Lang, an organizer for the iconic 1969 Woodstock Music Festival, as well as the events in 94 and 99. I think I said 1969. Don Maynard, NFL Hall of Fame and Super Bowl winning wide receiver who played with the New York Jets. Chris Dickerson, the first African-American to win Mr. America title in 1970. One of the very few openly gay bodybuilders at the time. He also won Mr. Olympia in 1980. Clyde Belcourt, civil rights activist who co-founded AIM, the American Indian Movement. Dion Lindor, only 29, Olympic and World Championship medalist from Trinidad and Tobago, died in a car accident in Texas. Tim Rosefort, golf writer and broadcaster, the first journalist to be awarded honorary membership by the PGA of America. Ronnie Spector was a 1960s icon. She was produced by her then husband, Phil Spector, and she became the leader of the group, the Ronettes, known for their primary for their number one single. I know, Commissioner Giraldo's itching to sing this. Be My Baby. Be My Baby. Be My Little Baby, which would signal the defining sound of the girl group era. And of course, we extend our deep, hot off the presses, we just learned that the former Maryland Attorney General Steve Sachs just passed peacefully in his home after a very brief illness, age 87. And of course, we extend our deepest sympathy to any of you who may have suffered the loss of a loved one as well. We open and extend our hearts to you. If we may have that moment of silence, please. Thank you. Okay. It is January 13th. It is the month of January 1st. It is, where's my list here? It is National Soup Month. It is Human Trafficking and Slavery Prevention Month. It is National Hot Tea Month, and so many others. But I'm going to skip over some of that because we have so many announcements today that I want to go straight to the January 13th. So January 13th is also known as Korean American Day. It commenced on the first known arrival of the Korean immigrants to the United States in 1903. It also commemorates and honors the immense contributions of Korean Americans to every single aspect of our society. January 13th, 1966, President Lyndon Baines Johnson appointed the very first African American to a U.S. presidential cabinet. Economist and academic Dr. Robert Weaver was appointed as Secretary of Housing and Urban Development, HUD, at that time. January 13th, 1979, sadly, singer, songwriter, keyboardist, and soul legend Donny Hathaway committed suicide in New York City on this day at the tender age of 33. You may remember him by his famous songs, The Ghetto, his holiday song, This Christmas, his teaming up with Roberta Flack, Where is the Love? And there are many more, but my favorite, A Song for You, just beautiful and profound. 1979, the YMCA, the entity the YMCA, filed suit against the Village People claiming that the song YMCA defamed the YMCA organization. They filed suit. However, after witnessing the popularity of the song, the YMCA entity quickly not only dropped their lawsuit, but then adopted the hit song as their unofficial song for the entity. Funny how things change. January 13th, 1982, Hammer and Hank Aaron and Frank Robinson were elected to the Baseball Hall of Fame in Cooperstown, New York. Also, 1982, January 13th, many of us will remember that morning when the Air Florida 737 took off in a snowstorm and ended up crashing into the 14th Street Bridge in Washington, D.C. and wound up in the freezing waters of the Potomac River. The crash killed 78 people. January 13th, 1990, Doug Wilder became the first African-American elected governor as he assumed office in the state of Virginia. 1994, Tanya Harding's bodyguard, Sean Eric Eckhart, and Brian Smith arrested and charged with conspiracy in the attack of Olympic figure skater Nancy Kerrigan. We remember that too. January 13, 1999, Michael Jordan announced his not first, but second retirement just prior to the 1989-99 NBA season. But wait, he returned again in 2001. So that's that for that at the moment. But I want to tell you a story. I give so many announcements, and this is really important because people ask this question of me an awful lot. Why? I am decked out in my red and white today for a good reason. And people ask this question about African-American fraternities and sororities. And they ask that question because they say, well, isn't that a college thing? And then once you graduate, you know, you've all grown up and you don't need that anymore. Wrong. That's not the case. And there's a different significance because the African-Americans in that era were excluded from the other sororities, excluded from certain places of where they could gather socially, excluded from clubs, excluded from restaurants and things like that. And if they were admitted, they had a separate section, which is usually way in the back in the dark in the corner, or in a theater, way in the back in the balcony, you know. So they had to form organizations that were not merely about gathering socially. There was that component as well, but they were gathered about emphasis on education, because most of these were first-time college attendees and later graduates, and they knew the importance of an education so they could teach others to read, and they could take that education back to their respective communities and work towards securing rights, the right to vote, to fight oppression, to stand for civil rights, for social justice, for service, and to create opportunities for so many others. And it was so important. And therefore, in these particular organizations, the work postgraduate becomes all the more important because you're then grown up, you have matured, and you realize the importance of what you bring. You're supposed to use that education. You're supposed to use that drive. You're supposed to use all of that for the betterment of your respective communities. So, and that is why so many of us are so firmly engaged at an older age post-graduation so that we can improve our communities and uplift our communities. And though they started out as solely African-American organizations because we weren't admitted to the other organizations, they are now open to the public, and not to the public, but to people of all races, all denominations. And so they're not exclusively African-American any longer. But our charge remains the same, to promote social justice, to fight for our communities, to eradicate injustice, to promote opportunities for people. And that is why it becomes all the more important now to stay engaged. I don't care how old we are or how young we are. So that is why this is so important. So I'm going to take this opportunity to celebrate the anniversaries and the founders days of some of these organizations. And I'm going to start with happy 108th anniversary to the men of Phi Beta Sigma, the historically black fraternity founded at Howard University in 1914. And many of those, so that was on January 9th. And many of those were notables, or we can't go through all the notables, but George Washington Carver, the incomparable John Lewis, Blair Underwood, and my classmate Al Roker. We're also going to say happy on January 15th, so we're a little bit early. Happy 114th anniversary to the dynamic, beautiful women of the Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority, also founded at Howard University in 1908, breaking barriers for African-American women and creating opportunities for them. Many of them include actress Felicia Rashad, author Toni Morrison, singer Ella Fitzgerald, Vice President Kamala Harris, so many others. But also I want to take a moment to say, Katherine Johnson, who was a scientist and computer genius before we actually had the kind of computers that you see. And she died recently at the last year or in 2020 at the age of 101. And she helped bring astronaut John Glenn and Apollo 11 back down to Earth after they had a calamity on flight. So we want to remember her as well. And I said Vice President Kamala Harris and Jacqueline Woody, who's a stalwart in the Prince George's County community. And let me think. Oh yes, there's another fantastic, dynamic, amazing woman of many, many talents who has contributed tremendously to the sorority Alpha Kappa Alpha. And we are looking at her right now. She is donning her pink and green. And I'd like to give a shout out to our Madam Vice Chair, Dorothy Bailey, and say happy early, happy anniversary to you for the AKAs as well. And that would be your 114th anniversary. January 16th, the next day, we want to say happy 102nd anniversary to the women of Zeta Phi Beta Sorority, also founded on the campus of Howard University, also emphasizing service, charity, and scholarship. Most notably, Zora Neale Hurston. Thank you. I'm getting tongue-tied. Thank you. Marjorie Joyner, Sarah Vaughn, and our wonderful CEO of WSSC, Carla Reed. So we want to thank the women and say happy 102nd anniversary and Founders Day to the women of Zeta Phi Beta. But wait, today, January 13th, 2022, we celebrate the 109th anniversary of Delta Sigma Theta Sorority, Incorporated, also formed on the campus of Howard University on January 13th, 1913. Founded on the principles of sisterhood, scholarship, and service, and emphasis on social action and furthering social justice. The first action that the sorority took less than 7 weeks after its formation was to participate in the Women's Suffrage March in Washington, D.C. on March 3rd, 1913, to secure the right to vote for women. We're about taking care of business. So some of the famous and notable Delta Sigma Theta sorority members are the Honorable Shirley Chisholm, bring your own chair, the Honorable Barbara Jordan, Cicely Tyson, Lena Horn, Honorable Marcia Fudge, Nikki Giovanni, Betty Shabazz, the widow of Malcolm X, Dr. Charlene Dukes, former president of the Prince George's County Community College, and Felicia Williams, current president of the Community College, Chief Judge of the Circuit Court, Sheila Tillerson Adams. Oh, and yours truly, Miss Betty. Okay. And we have many, many members of our sororities and fraternities within the Maryland National Capital Parking Planning Commission. I want to give a shout out to all of them, but I thought it was important to explain this history because so many people ask why. They think it's fun and games and playtime. It is not fun and games and playtime. It's about taking care of business. It's about improving society. It is about furthering social justice. It is about creating opportunities. It is about teaching people to read. It is about scholarship. It is about service. And that is why we remain firmly engaged, because all of us know, and they're part of the Divine Nine, all of us know that the world is bigger than us. It does not revolve around us as individuals. We are about the business of taking care of business and uplifting together. So that is what I have to say about that. I want to announce, can we go to slide number one, please? The Prince George's County Council sitting as a district council and along with the planning board, so planning board, we need a quorum, will hold a virtual joint public hearing on Tuesday, January 18th at 5 p.m. to take testimony on the preliminary Adelphi Road, University of Maryland Global Campus, University of Maryland Purple Line Station Area Sector Plan and proposed SMA. So please see the screen for the links to sign up or submit comments, or you can watch live stream of the hearing or look to learn more about the project. Next slide. Join the Planning Department's Master Plan of Transportation 2035 team to discuss existing conditions and the future of transportation around the county. The Planning Department will host three countywide community engagement meetings at 6 p.m. on Tuesday, January 25th, Wednesday the 26th, and Thursday the 27th. Choose only one date and register for one of these meetings by visiting the web address listed on the screen. Placemaking. The Planning Department will host a virtual kickoff meeting for the Suitland Project with Creative Suitland and the Better Block Foundation. That will be on Wednesday the 19th at 6:30 p.m. You can learn about the upcoming project, provide feedback, and sign up to volunteer for a two-day fun-filled arts and community event scheduled for April. Please see the screen address for advanced registration. Finally, hot off the presses, and oh my goodness, I can't tell you about how long the lines are for these at-home COVID test kits. The Park and Planning Commission, in conjunction with the Prince George's County Health Department, the Office of Emergency Management, also the Prince George's County Libraries, in conjunction with Prince George's County, will be distributing 25,000 free COVID-19 at-home test kits each week as designated at the designated community centers and libraries within the county. You can take a look at those. So one box will be distributed per person. You must be present, and then for ages 2 and older, residents are required to show proof of county residency, driver's license, utility bill, lease agreement to receive the test. So there will be distributed Wednesdays at 10 a.m. And yesterday the lines were off the chain. They started at 10 a.m. The lines started forming at 8 a.m. Some sites are drive-through. Some you have to park, depending on the location. And please visit our website also for updates, because we may make adjustments as we work through the traffic issues that we encountered yesterday. Thursdays, they will commence at 8 a.m. So please see the website on the screen for more details. Finally, we want to acknowledge that January 15th is the actual birthday of the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King. If ever there was a man who championed so much for civil rights without anger, but still forcefully and vehemently, but without anger, while promoting love, it was the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King. And he accomplished so very much for us. And one thing that he reminds us of, and I chose this quote intentionally, because when you see an injustice, you cannot sit back and do nothing. You cannot be silent about that. So our lives begin to end the day we become silent about things that matter. You have been given a voice. Use that voice to educate, to eradicate injustices. Do what you need to do to promote love and end some of the madness that we see right now. Finally, I wanted to say this. As we get ready to celebrate Martin Luther King Day, we also had some birthdays here. Last week, we announced the birthday of our technical hearing writer, Marie Proctor. And today we are so pleased to extend happy birthday wishes to our planning board administrator, Jessica Jones, who's sitting right here in the room, who's probably thoroughly embarrassed and giving me dirty looks over here. So can we all say, turn mics up, can we all say happy birthday, Jessica?
Happy birthday.
Happy birthday,
Jessica.
Birthday.
Happy
birthday to you.
Okay, Commissioner, draw those mic off, please. Okay. Again, I can say that these are very tough times. We continue grappling with the anxiety, the stress, the fear, the loss of friends, the loved ones, and the COVID cases are spreading just ridiculously at this point. I mean, we can't even keep up. But yet we struggle and we push forward because we're resilient. you know, we've just had so many cases and we're all at higher risk now because the Omicron is far more contagious. It may be less egregious, but far more contagious again than the Delta variant. And in a matter of 2 weeks, a couple of weeks ago, the Delta variant was the predominant variant. Now it's the Omicron. So it's, you know, you need to, not only do you need to mask up, but you need to double mask up. And the vaccine and the booster will not necessarily prevent you from getting it, but there's a huge likelihood that it will prevent you from being hospitalized or requiring to be placed in the ICU and requiring a ventilator, or it decreases the likelihood of death. So you please, unless you have a valid medical reason or other exemption, please get vaccinated and get boosted. It is critical to your survival and the survival of your loved ones and the safety of your loved ones. So we want to just say that. I thank you for your and appreciate your flexibility and cooperation and support as we continue our planning functions in this safe fashion. And as we embark on today's hearings, we remain thankful for our blessings. And we ask that you make every effort to be kind, to stay safe, and to look out for one another, and to stay strong and stay resilient. We have been fraught with challenges in 2020. Pandemic, politics, egregious events, civil rights violations, and the new year started with challenges, but remain ever hopeful that things will change. We can turn the corner in this new year, and it's up to you to help us do that. So I close by sharing a profoundly simple thought. Actually, it was a question expressed by Dr. Martin Luther King, and in which I so firmly believe. And now in these challenging times, especially more than ever. So life's most persistent and urgent question is what he said. Life's most persistent and urgent question is, what have you done for others? Thank you. Stay hopeful. We will get through these challenging times together. The first item on our agenda is the resolution for Wendy Erminger. So now what do I do with this? Wendy has been with the commission for I think it was 37 years. I can't find it. She's done a fantastic job, and she's, let me see, it's 37 years. Whereas Wendy Erminger has ably and conscientiously served the citizens of Prince George's County for 36 years as a dedicated staff member within the Prince George's County Planning Department, and her tenure with the County Planning Department, Wendy has admirably earned multiple promotions and serves in several roles, including planning technician in the Zoning Division, Planner 3 in the Director's Office, and Planner Coordinator within the Community Planning Division and the Neighborhood Revitalization Section. In testimony to her journey within the commission, Wendy Erminger worked on numerous projects and initiatives, including research and innovative zoning techniques, drafting of critical areas legislation, and the Woodland Conservation Ordinance, and the reignition of the Planning Assistance to Municipalities and Communities program, which is a highly successful program. Wendy has done so much. I'm not going to read this entire proclamation resolution for her. But I would like to take this opportunity to say huge thank you to Wendy for all that she has given to the commission. She's just done a yeoman's job, and we're so deeply appreciative of everything that she has done. So I'd like to take this moment to offer, our planning director is on, I'd like to give her the opportunity to make a comment or two regarding Ms. Erminger.
Thank you. Excuse me. Thank you, Madam Chair. Good morning, members of the board. Yes, it is very sad that Wendy has decided to retire, but who can blame her? She's done quite a bit in her long, illustrious career, and she's made Prince George's County better. She's made the planning department better, and we will miss her. Congratulations, Wendy. Thank you.
Thank you, Wendy. I meant to announce that all of her 30 years have been spent within the planning department here in Prince George's County, and her retirement was effective as of January 1st, 2022. She's worked on so many projects, but also I wanted to highlight that she worked on the Diversity Council and contributed to the 2019-2021 Strategic Plan, Women's History Month celebration, and other projects promoting diversity, equity, and inclusion all throughout the commission. So we want to give a huge shout out. Wendy Erminger, I hope you're watching. Know that we miss you, but we wish you much happiness in your retirement. And there will be others soon to follow. So with that, is there a motion to approve the resolution?
Motion to approve, Madam Chair. Second.
Okay, so we'll give the motion to Commissioner Washington, seconded by Madam Vice Chair. Madam Vice Chair.
Vote aye.
Commissioner Washington.
Vote aye.
Commissioner Dorner.
Vote aye.
And Commissioner Giraldo.
Vote aye, Madam Chair.
The ayes have it 5-0. Thank you. The next item, congratulations, Ms. Erminger, and hello to husband Doug. So the next item on the agenda is the draft minutes of the January 6, 2022 meeting. Is there a motion?
Move approval, Madam Chair.
Is there a second?
Second.
We have a motion by Madam Vice Chair, seconded by Commissioner Washington. Madam Vice Chair.
Vote aye.
Commissioner Washington.
Vote aye.
Commissioner Dorner.
Vote aye.
And Commissioner Giraldo.
Vote aye.
The ayes have it 5-0. Thank you. Next item on our agenda is item 3C. It's the FY22 special revenue fund amendment for historic preservation and non-capital grant fund. Mr. Johnson, are you on? Who's present?
Yes, this is Terry Johnson. I'm on.
Okay. Do you need to you have a presentation, or do you just need to vote?
Yes, ma'am. Good morning. And members of the board, I'm Chairwoman Hewlett. For the record, I'm Terry Johnson, budget manager for the planning department. I'll be brief today. I'm coming here today to request an amendment to our FY22 Historic Preservation Non-Capital Grant Fund. We need spending authority. When we put our FY22 budget together, we based it off of historical trends. We were basically spending close to roughly about $15,000 a year. So we budgeted it at $20,000 for 22. However, through December of this year, the Historic Preservation Commission has awarded up to $35,000 in grants. At this point, we don't have spending authority to actually distribute the funds. So I'm coming here this morning to request that we increase our spending authority by an additional $100,000. We believe that this will be ample funding to cover us through the end of this fiscal year. And just to provide a little brief background, some of you may or may not recall that the county transferred $357,000 to the commission back in fiscal year 2019. For the planning department to administer this non-capital grant fund for the county. And we've been pretty much sitting on that 357. We've distributed close to roughly about, I think close to about maybe $55,000 for the term of this program since 2019. We unexpectedly received some additional funds from the county this year. We received a check for $550,000 to add to this fund. And I'll just point out that these funds come from money that is collected by the county for mitigation for the loss of historic sites throughout the county. But with that presentation, I'm requesting approval to amend our budget for this fund by $100,000 for fiscal year 22.
Okay, and we have the whole presentation. I know we went through this yesterday, so let's see if the board has any questions of Mr. Johnson at this time. And I know Mr. Berger and Mr. Tanner were here just as backup. I don't know that they're needed this time, Mr. Johnson, or they're here. Do we have any questions? All right. Okay, so are there any questions, Madam Vice Chair?
No questions. Thank you, Mr. Johnson. Thank you.
Commissioner Washington?
No questions.
All right, Commissioner Dorner?
No questions.
Commissioner Giraldo?
No questions, Madam Chair.
Okay, so if there's a motion, I'd love to entertain it, thank you.
Madam Chair.
And I second.
Okay, we have a motion by Madam Vice Chair, seconded by Commissioner Washington. Madam Vice Chair.
Vote aye.
Commissioner Washington.
Vote aye.
Commissioner Joyner.
Vote aye.
Commissioner Geraldo.
Vote aye, Madam Chair.
The ayes have it 5-0. Thank you very much. Thank you, Mr. Johnson.
Thank you.
The next item on our agenda is the consent agenda, items 4D through 4G. Is there any board member who wishes to discuss these? And if not, we'll entertain a motion.
Madam Chair, for consideration of the records of items number 4D through 4G, with a revision in item 4-3. There is a revision in one of the items. I'm not certain which one that is now. 4G.
Okay.
I move adoption minus approval of items on the consent agenda in accordance with the recommendation of staff. And there's a revision in one of the resolutions.
Mr. Hunt, can you guide Madam Vice Chair? It's what? No, it's not this one. It is. It's the parks item. Yeah, it's just draft. That's not a big deal. No, that's fine.
Okay.
Yeah, the motion stands. Okay. Was there a second?
Second.
Commissioner Washington. Okay, Madam Vice Chair.
Vote aye.
Commissioner Washington.
Vote aye.
Commissioner Joyner.
Vote aye.
And Commissioner Geraldo.
Vote aye.
The ayes have it 5-0. Thank you so very much. So the next item, I'm gonna give folks a heads up. We're gonna proceed in this order. We're gonna go through items 6, 5, and 8. 6, 5, 8, and 9 for starters. Okay. So item 6, we have is detailed site plan 21003 Hill Road property. We have a request for a continuance to an unspecified date. I wanna make sure we have Mr. Haller, are you on?
I'm present, thank you.
Wonderful. Ms. Butler, are you on?
Yes, ma'am.
And Ms. Butler, since we were talking about fraternities and sororities, I would like to give you a shout out that you are a member of Sigma Gamma Rho sorority, and your anniversary was in this past November, but this November, you celebrate your centennial. Is that not correct?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so early congrats. I won't be here then, but early congrats to you. So
happy Founders Day to you, Madam Chair, and happy early Founders Day to you, Madam Vice Chair, Commissioner Bailey.
Thank you. So with that, Ms. Butler, you can proceed.
And good morning, Madam Chair, again. Good morning, Madam Chair, again, and members of the board. For the record, I'm Tiara Butler with the Urban Design Section. The applicant participated in a community meeting and concerns were raised at that meeting, which would result in a modification to the detailed site plan. The applicant is requesting a continuance of the currently scheduled hearing in order to work with the community representatives to resolve the concerns raised. As a result, the applicant is requesting the planning board hearing date be continued to an unspecified date and a waiver of the 70-day review requirement to allow the applicant to work with the community to address these concerns. And in conclusion, staff recommends that planning board approve the request to continue indefinitely. And this concludes staff's presentation.
Okay, I doubt there are any questions. Let's just go straight to Mr. Haller and then we'll see if the board has any questions. Mr. Haller.
Thank you. Good morning, Madam Chair, members of the board. Thomas Haller on behalf of the applicant. Yes, we're requesting an indefinite continuance. We've had some meetings with the community and they've expressed some concerns, and we wanted to give the appropriate time and attention necessary to address those concerns. And because we are not sure how long it will take for us to make the changes to the plan and get back to the community, we are asking for an indefinite continuance. We understand that will require that the site be reposted, but we're comfortable with that.
Okay, thank you. Does the board have, and that concludes the silent list, so does the board have any questions of Ms. Butler or Mr. Haller? Madam Vice Chair?
No questions, thank you.
Commissioner Washington?
No questions.
Commissioner Joyner?
No questions.
Okay, and Commissioner Geraldo?
No questions, Madam Chair.
So we'll entertain a motion.
Madam Chair, I move that we accept the recommendation of staff and approve the indefinite continuance of GSP-21003. And thank you, Mr. Howler, for requesting the continuance and furtherance of continued collaboration and dialogue with the citizens.
Thank you. It is our pleasure.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion by Commissioner Washington, seconded by Commissioner Geraldo. Madam Vice Chair.
Vote aye.
Commissioner Washington.
Vote aye.
Commissioner Dorner.
Vote aye.
And Commissioner Geraldo.
Vote aye.
Okay. I'm not going to ask you to sing Be My Little Baby, Mr. Howler. Okay.
I've got it on YouTube if you want it.
Okay. No. We're good. Okay, thank you. The motion carries 5-0. Next item on our agenda is item 5, which is an extension request for preliminary plan of subdivision 4-04035 South Lake, which we know was formerly Carrington. I'm going to make sure we have everyone we need. Mr. Diaz Campbell?
Present, Madam Chair.
Wonderful. Mr. Horan, we see you. Okay. Mr. Tedesco?
Good morning, Madam Chair. I'm here.
Okay, there you are. And Mr. Woodburn?
Good morning. I'm here.
Okay, wonderful. And that concludes the sign-up list. So, Mr. Diaz Campbell, you are on.
All right. Good morning, Madam Chair, members of the board. For the record, I am Eddie Diaz Campbell, Senior Planner with the Subdivision Section. Item number 5 on the agenda is an extension request for preliminary plan of subdivision 4-04035 South Lake. This preliminary plan of subdivision was approved by the Planning Board on October 21, 2004, and it is valid through December 31, 2021, due to prior legislative extensions of the plan's validity period approved by the County Council. The letter dated October 29, 2021, the applicant requested a 2-year extension of the plan's approval. This is the applicant's first extension request. If this request is approved, the plan will be valid through December 31, 2023. Subject preliminary plan approved 800 lots and 110 parcels for the development of 1,294 dwelling units and 675,000 square feet of gross floor area. Section 24-119D of the subdivision regulations, as modified by CB-93-2021, authorizes the planning board to grant an extension to the normal expiration of the preliminary plan when certain criteria are met. For this preliminary plan, the criteria under Section 24-119D6 apply. These criteria are listed in the staff memorandum. Pursuant to Section 24-119D6A, this plan is valid for a 6-year validity period and is eligible for the requested extension because it has more than 300,000 square feet of commercial development in a comprehensive design zone, specifically the employment and institutional area zone. Pursuant to Section 24-119D6B, an extension of up to 2 years from the expiration of the preliminary plan may be granted by the planning board if public infrastructure, which was determined to be the developer's responsibility, has been constructed by the developer in order to accommodate all stages of the development, or if the developer has been proceeding in a diligent manner to complete the development and has been unable, through no fault of the developer, to complete development within the time frame specified, or if a staging plan applied to the approval cannot be met as a result of government failure to extend necessary services or infrastructure. Staff found that the developer has been proceeding in a diligent manner to complete the development and that has not been and that has been through no fault of their own that they have been unable to complete the development within the plan's validity time frame. Based on information given by the applicant in their October 29 letter and a revised letter dated December 30, 2021, the applicant was unable to move forward on the development between 2007 and 2016. However, this lack of activity may be accounted for by the effects of the nationwide 2007 to 2009 recession. Since 2016, the applicant has continued to pursue development of the project, seeking approval of a variety of plans, including tree conservation plans, natural resource inventory plans, detailed site plans, and final plats. The applicant also needed to work extensively with the Maryland State Highway Administration and Washington Suburban Sanitary Commission on infrastructure before the first final plat could be recorded in June 2020. Additional applications and permits were also required by the City of Bowie. Due to the length of time needed to work with these agencies, it is not the fault of the applicant that the development cannot be completed within the validity timeframe. Based on staff's findings, staff recommends approval of the 2-year extension request for preliminary plan assumption 4-04035 South Lake, pursuant to section 24-119D6BI of the subdivision regulations. This concludes staff's presentation.
Thank you, Mr. Diaz-Campbell. I'm going to see if, well, you know what, I think I'll just go straight to Mr. Horn and then see if the board has any questions of either of you at this time. Mr. Horn, you're on.
Good morning, Madam Chairman, members of the Planning Board. For the record, Arthur Horn of the Law Office of Shipley on Horn, here with co-counsel Matt Tedesco. First of all, let me wish you all a happy new year. I didn't appear before you at Planning Board, so I haven't seen any of you this year. So happy new year to all of you all. It's good to be back. I just want to first stop and thank Mr. Eddie Diaz-Campbell for his presentation, his thoroughness as usual. Also, Ms. Sherry Connor, we agree with the statements set forth by Mr. Diaz-Campbell in his application. I'm here representing South Lake Partnership LLC, which is a combination of the Chesapeake Realty Partners and the NAM Micro Companies. And as you all know, we've been before you a number of times. This project's so big, this project has, two attorneys, myself and Mr. Tedesco. They have two civil engineering firms. Mr. Woodburn's here with Ben Dyer, Rogers Consultants involved. As indicated, this 382 acre site with over 1,300 developments is moving forward. And your backup materials that you have charged shows the dozens upon dozens of permits filed with the WSSC, City of Bowie, DPI, SHA. Everything's moving forward. And actually, if you've driven by off of 301 lately, you can see that whole area is graded and moving forward. They're very excited about the project. Everything is moving forward. We do feel as if we meet the criteria of 24-119B6II. And again, we concur with the staff's backup and respectfully ask the planning board to grant a 2-year extension. And I'm here to answer any questions that you may have.
Thank you, Mr. Horn. I'm going to turn to our board to see if they're if they have any questions of either you or Mr. Diaz-Campbell at this time, and then we'll turn see if Mr. Tedesco has anything to add and after your remarks. Madam Vice Chair?
No questions. Thank you.
Commissioner Washington?
No questions.
Commissioner Dorner?
No questions.
Commissioner Giraldo?
No questions, Madam Chair.
Okay, thank you. So, Mr. Tedesco, did you wish to speak? Did you have anything to add?
I would just align myself with my co-counsel, Mr. Horn, and echo his thoughts and comments, and wishing everybody a happy new year and respectfully requesting the extension that's been requested by the applicant pursuant to 24-119-D6B to little I. Thank you.
Thank you. And Mr. Woodburn, did you have anything else to add?
Just happy new year to everybody and thanks.
Okay, I will just say this. I'm going to call for a motion and then I have a comment. So, Madam Vice Chair, is there a motion?
Madam Chair, I move that we accept the recommendation of staff and approve the 2-year extension of preliminary plan 4-04035.
We have a motion from Commissioner Washington, seconded by Madam Vice Chair. Under discussion, I'd like to add that. So this is a huge project and you can see it. I drive by there all the time and you can really see it come to fruition. I was honored to be a part of the board that approved this. I think it was maybe 2004, if I remember correctly. And we really and truly want this project to be a success. And so, and I will say this, the planning board was happy to work very diligently in a challenging fashion to contribute to, not only to that vote back in 2004, but to the other success of this project in terms of Liberty Park, because that one will enhance the other. And it took a great deal of effort, but it took all of us working together. It took the private sector because we want your hotel and this development to be a huge success for the benefit of Prince George's County, but also for people who come from other places to visit. And that helps our accessible base. That helps in so many ways. But it also, the Prince George's County, it benefits the county also because of the improvements and enhancements to the accessible base. But it also benefits and now through our diligence. And I want to thank Commissioner Dorner in particular, but the board, but Commissioner Dorner worked so tirelessly on Liberty Park. And so now it also benefits the youth of Prince George's County because we have contributed tremendously to that aspect, and the youth are getting time for classes and field time and usage there. So everyone benefits, the private sector benefits, Prince George's County benefits, the youth benefit, and all of our visitors benefit. And that's what I call win-win-win. It was a long time coming, but it all worked out in the end. So I wanted to say thank you to everyone, to Commissioner Dorner in particular. Thank you to the planning board. Thank you to the private sector for working so hard. Thank you to Gary Michael for working so hard. Thank you to Prince George's County, and we all came together. So now that was my discussion. I know, is there any additional discussion? I'm gonna call for the vote. Madam Vice Chair?
No additional discussion, but I would like to associate myself with your comments, and in particularly the importance it is to always remember our youth in our county in all of our endeavors, because eventually they will be the ones in charge, and we must be do everything we can to prepare them for that. So thank you very much for your comments, and I vote aye.
Thank you. Commissioner Washington?
I vote aye.
Commissioner Dorner, the man.
I'll put aye, and well said by yourself and by Madam Vice Chair. Thank you.
Thank you. And Commissioner Giraldo, last year, there you are.
You're muted. I am?
No, not anymore. You're not anymore.
I was about to start singing. I associate myself with all of my fellow commissioners' comments. There's nothing more important than the youth of our county.
Thank you. So the motion carries 5-0. Congratulations. Okay.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. So the next item on our agenda is, it is item 8, which is an extension request for preliminary plan of subdivision 4-07050 Livingston of Fort Washington. Mr. Heath, are you on?
Present, Madam Chair.
Wonderful. And Mr. Horn, you're still with us. Very good. And there are no other speakers signed up. So Mr. Heath, you are on.
Thank you. Good morning, Madam Chair, members of the board. For the record, I'm Antoine Heath with the subdivision section. Item number 8 is an extension request for preliminary plan of subdivision 4-07050 Livingston of Fort Washington. This preliminary plan was approved on December 6, 2007. And the expiration date was December 31st, 2021, due to prior legislative extensions of the validity period by the County Council. By letter dated October 29th, 2021, and revised on December 22nd, the applicant's representative, Arthur Horn, requested a one-year extension of the plan's approval to December 31st, 2022. This is the applicant's first extension request. The preliminary plan of subdivision approved 5 parcels for the development of 80,000 square feet of commercial use. In accordance with section 24-119D5A of the subdivision regulations, planning board has the authority to grant an extension of the normal expiration of a preliminary plan of subdivision if certain criteria are met. For this preliminary plan of subdivision, the applicant has to comply with at least 5 criteria, and that has to comply with 5 criteria, excuse me. And these are listed in the staff's memo. Staff finds that all these criteria have been met. In particular, criteria under subsections B3 and B4, as the applicant has been diligently pursuing development of the site. However, the right-of-way of Master Plan Freeway Maryland 210 overlaps the property's boundaries. As a result, staff condition that this area be placed in reservation, and this requires the applicant to work with the Maryland State Highway Administration to obtain a right-of-way determination. The SHA decision on that right-of-way determination was just made in 2021. Given this, as well as the applicant's need to take advantage of previous legislative extensions, staff recommends the planning board approve the one-year extension request of preliminary plan of subdivision 4-07050 Livingston Road, Livingston, Fort Washington. This concludes staff's presentation.
Thank you, Mr. Heath. You know what? I'm so sorry. Mr. Heath and Mr. Gibbs. Oh no, I'm wrong. Okay. So I got Mr. Horn. There was no one else on. That's right. Okay, thank you. Mr. Horn?
Thank you again, Madam Chair, members of the planning board. For the record, Arthur Horn with the law offices of Shippey and Horn, here on behalf of the applicant, Livingston at Fort Washington LLC, Maureen Wood. Although he did not sign up with us, a lot of the work in this case for the past few years have been done by my colleague, Mr. Tedesco. So I want to thank him for helping putting this project in a position where we can ask for this one-year extension on behalf of the applicant. You certainly would ask that you adopt the findings of facts and conclusions as set forth by the applicant as we put forth in the backup material that you have, and that park and planning and their recommendation of. This is a 12-acre piece that has had a huge cloud hanging over its head that's prevented them from moving forward. And as you heard, that's been the State Highway Administration. The preliminary plan in this case required two parcels to be placed in reservation for a three-year period, but we hadn't been able to do it because because State Highway Administration hadn't stated forth their desire for this project. So after years of working on this to try to get them to move, the applicant finally filed his DSP in 2020, but that sort of helped SHA get off the dime a little bit. And finally, as mentioned, in February of 2021, they finally agreed that the State Highway has no interest in this property. So the applicant is able to proceed. We have, again, as I mentioned, a DSP that's in the system. Looking forward to moving forward. And just want to thank you for your consideration for allowing this project to be able to move forward.
Thank you, Mr. Horn. I will just say, I was remiss in not saying this for the last case, but thank you for your extensive documentation, because that's what helps us make the decision on whether to grant the extension or not. But particularly with the last case where you had tons and tons of documentation regarding the permits and whatnot. But both cases, so thank you for that. I do want to ask you, is that a red and white tie you're wearing? But okay.
It is, and a happy Founders Day to you, Madam Chair.
Okay. Okay, thank you. So are there any questions of Mr. Horn at this time? Is there a motion?
Madam Chair, I move that we accept the recommendation of staff and approve the one-year extension of preliminary plan 4-07050.
Second.
We have a motion by Commissioner Washington, seconded by Madam Vice Chair. Madam Vice Chair?
Vote aye.
Commissioner Washington?
Vote aye.
Commissioner Dorner?
Aye.
And Commissioner Geraldo?
I vote aye, Madam Chair, but I just want to make a comment. I'm glad that this project can move forward, but this is just another example, me living in South County, that the State Department of Highways, Department of Transportation seems to ignore South County, particularly 210. It's the most dangerous highway in the state, or at least in the region, and they do very little improve and enhance the safety of 210. Thank you, and I vote aye.
Thank you. It is very dangerous for a lot of reasons. The ayes have it 5-0. Thank you. Okay. Okay, so now I'll jump the gun. Mr. Heath, you remain on. Okay, is that not correct? Okay, and then Mr. Gibbs, do I see you? Edward, yeah, there we go. Okay, somebody's, okay, Mr. Gibbs, there you are. Okay, so we only have Mr. Heath and Mr. Gibbs. This is extension request for preliminary plan of subdivision 4-11004, Stevens Crossing at Brandywine. We have Mr. Heath and Mr. Gibbs. Do we also have Michael Fitzgerald? Are you present?
Yes, I'm here.
Okay.
Yeah, Mr. Fitzgerald, be here for questions. Thank you.
Okay. And then we also have Rich Tometz.
Same situation, Madam Chair. Just for questions.
I don't see him. Okay.
Okay.
But he has He signed up, but I don't know that he made it. He did sign up. I'm sorry. Okay. Mr. Heath, you're on.
Good morning again, Madam Chair, members of the board. For the record, I'm Antoine Heath, subdivision section. Item number 9 is an extension request for a preliminary plan of subdivision 4-11004, Stevens Crossing. This preliminary plan was approved on October 2nd, 2014, and the expiration date was December 31st, 2021, due to prior legislative extensions of the validity period by County Council. Also, I would like to correct the record, as the staff memo indicates that the applicant's representative sent the letter dated October 29th, 2021. The letter was actually dated October 28th, 2021. And in this letter, the applicant's representative, Ed Gibbs, requested a 6-year extension of the plan's approval to December 31st, 2027. This is the applicant's first extension request. The preliminary plan of subdivision approved 379 lots and 73 parcels for the development of 1,295 dwelling units and 300,000 square feet of commercial development in the MXT zone. This preliminary plan is eligible for a 6-year extension in accordance with section 24-119D6 of the subdivision regulations. At least one of these criteria are needed to be in conformance, and this application meets all three. It consists of more than 400 dwelling units, more than 150 acres, and consists of at least 300,000 square feet of commercial development in the MXT zone. In accordance with section 24-119D6B of the subdivision regulations as amended by County Council Bill CB-93-2021, the planning board has the authority to grant an extension of the normal expiration of a preliminary plan of subdivision if certain criteria are met. For this preliminary plan of subdivision, the applicant has to comply with at least one of the criteria, and these are listed in the staff memo. Staff finds that criteria under subsection B2 have been met, as the applicant has been proceeding diligently to acquire a wetland permit from the Maryland Department of Environment and the United States Army Corps of Engineers. This wetland permit is needed to construct Master Plan Collector Road, Cattell Way, which is needed to access the site from the east. The site can also be accessed from Master Plan Arterial Road, Mattawoman Drive, to the west. However, the preliminary plan requires that Cattell Way be constructed first. It should also be noted that the applicant recently requested a waiver and reconsideration of the preliminary plan, which the board granted as a result of these environmental issues. Given these circumstances, staff is recommending approval of the 6-year extension request for preliminary plan of subdivision 4-11004, Stevens Crossing. This concludes staff's presentation.
Thank you, Mr. Heath. I'm going to turn to Mr. Gibbs at this time.
Good morning. Thank you, Chair Hewlett, members of the Planning Board. Edward Gibbs, an attorney with offices in Largo, very pleased to be here this morning representing this developer in this project, which is quite significant.
Mr. Gibbs, somebody is having the whole conversation. If we can mute everyone else except for Mr. Gibbs at this time, thank you. Because somebody, you can hear, it sounds like a female voice having a whole conversation. Okay, thank you. And now we're muting everyone else, and then we're going to unmute Mr. Gibbs.
Thank you very much. Yes. So now, this is a significant project, both in its breadth and scope and in its ability to bring about the construction of a critical link of Mattawoman Drive between Brandywine Road and US 301. I would simply note that, yes, there has been a motion for reconsideration on the phasing of Cattail Way. Granted, that reconsideration hearing has not yet occurred. But I would also only note that there are in addition, two wetland crossings for Mattawoman Drive, and so we couldn't have started that section of Mattawoman Drive because it was all under one wetland permit, and that was part of what generated the delay as well. But we thank Mr. Heath. We had some very productive conversations where he quite reasonably asked for more documentation, and we were able to provide it. and to fill in gaps that he very reasonably asked us to fill in. So we appreciate his thoughtfulness there, as well as Ms. Sherry Connor's guidance through that process. So with that being said, we would agree with staff recommendation. We would thank them for their recommendation of a six-year extension, which we believe is justified. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Gibbs. I'm gonna see if the board has any questions of either Mr. Heath or you. Madam Vice Chair?
No questions.
Thank you. Commissioner Washington?
No questions.
Commissioner Dorner?
No questions, thank you.
And Commissioner Giraldo?
I have no questions, thank you.
Thank you. Now, Mr. Gibbs, you said Mr. Fitzgerald is only here if we have questions. Is that correct?
That is correct, Chair Hewlett.
And Rich Thomas, we have him signed up, but I didn't see him. But is the same thing applies for him as well?
Absolutely, yes.
Okay. So if the board doesn't have any questions, we're at the point where we can entertain a motion.
Madam Chair, I move that we adopt the recommendation of staff in addition to the noted technical correction with regards to the letter date, and approve the six-year extension of preliminary plan 4-11004.
We have a motion. A motion by Commissioner Washington, seconded by Madam Vice Chair. Madam Vice Chair?
Vote aye.
Commissioner Washington?
Vote aye.
Commissioner Dorner?
Vote aye.
And Commissioner Giraldo?
Vote aye.
The ayes have it 5-0. Have a good day, Mr. Gibbs.
Okay. Thank you very much, Chair Hewlett, and thanks to the planning board and to staff. Have a great day and a great weekend.
And then when we put you on mute, you can start singing, okay?
I will, trust me.
Okay, thank you. As long as you're on mute. Okay, the next item is item 10, which is departure from sign design standard 715 MedStar Southern Maryland Hospital Center. Want to make sure we have everyone. Mr. Sievers, we see you. Good morning. Nate Foreman. Do I see you? There you are, Mr. Foreman. Okay. Christine Ray. Good morning. Christine Ray.
Good morning. Good morning.
Jim Applegate.
Good morning, Madam Chairman. I am here.
Wonderful. That concludes the sign up list for this item today. So, Mr. Sievers, you are on.
Thank you. Good morning, Madam Chair and members of the board. For the record, I am Thomas Sievers, Senior Planner with the Zoning Section. Item number 10 on the agenda is a departure from sign design standards for MedStar Southern Maryland Hospital Center, DSDS-715. The subject application requests a departure to allow the replacement of two existing smaller signs with one new larger monument sign. Slide 2, please. The site is located in the southern part of Prince George's County within Planning Area 81A, and Council District 9. Slide 3, please. More specifically, the site is located in the southeast quadrant of the intersection of MD5 Branch Avenue and Surrett's Road. Slide 4, please. The subject site is located in the rural residential RR zone and is bound by MD5 to the west, with lots in the residential townhouse RT zone beyond. Surrett's Road abuts the site to the north with institutional uses in the commercial office, CO, and RR zones, and a commercial use in the ancillary commercial, CA zone beyond. Additional institutional and residential uses in the RR zone are located to the east and south. Slide 5, please. The overlay map shows the site is within a military installation overlay for height restrictions. The application is in conformance with the overlay standards. Slide 6, please. The aerial photograph shows that the subject site is currently developed and also shows the surrounding properties and roadways. Slide 7, please. The site map shows that the topography of the subject area is level on a central bluff and slopes to the west towards Maryland 5. Slide 8, please. The master plan right-of-way map shows the master plan freeway Branch Avenue runs north along the western edge of the subject property, Surratt's Road abuts the site to the north and is designated as a collector roadway. Slide 9, please. The bird's eye view shows another angle of the subject property with the existing signs circled in red. Slide 10, please. The site plan shows the overall MedStar Hospital Center. The subject sign departure applies to Lot 8, seen towards the bottom of the slide. Lot 8 is the site of the former Colony South Hotel and is now under common ownership with MedStar. The new sign is associated with the modernization efforts and new emergency center located on lots 5 and 6 of the overall MedStar Hospital Center. Slide 11, please. The applicant submitted a statement of justification for a departure from section 27-617 of the zoning ordinance. As outlined on pages 5 through 7 of the technical staff report, the site meets all applicable zoning standards for signage, but requests a departure from both sign height and area. The required findings for approval of the departure have been met as set forth in the technical staff report. Slide 12, please. The proposed sign is 20 feet tall, approximately 17 feet for the signage itself, atop a 3-foot high base, amounting to a 12-foot increase in sign height. In addition, the proposed sign area is 333 square feet, resulting in a 285 square foot increase in sign area. The proposed increase in dimensions are associated with a decrease in the number of signs on site. The proposed larger sign will replace two smaller signs, thus the increase in dimensions. The sign will consist of an internally illuminated aluminum cabinet with LED lighting, a polycarbonate face, and aluminum skirting. Slide 13, please. This rendering shows the approximate location of the new sign on Lot 8, with it perched on the hillside out of the line of sight of motorists exiting from MD5. Slide 14, please. This slide shows another view of the sign's location on the site. Next slide, please. In conclusion, the zoning staff recommends that the Planning Board adopt the findings and approve the departure from sign design standards for MedStar Southern Maryland Hospital Center DSDS-715 without conditions. This concludes staff's presentation.
Wow, thank you, Mr. Severs. Appreciate it. I'm going to turn, well, let's see if the board has any questions of you at this time before we go to Mr. Foreman. Madam Vice Chair?
No questions.
Commissioner Washington?
No questions, thank you.
Okay, and Commissioner Dorner?
No questions.
Commissioner Geraldo?
No questions, Madam Chair.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Foreman, you are on.
Good morning, Madam Chair, members of the board. Happy New Year to all. For the record, Nate Foreman with the offices of O'Malley, Miles, Nyland, and Gilmore with offices in Greenbelt. With me this morning, it's my pleasure to have to answer any questions the board might have. Christine Ray, who is the president of the MedStar Southern Maryland Hospital Center, and Jim Applegate, who is our sign architect from Apple Signs. I'd like to begin by thanking Mr. Severs for his hard work in preparing the staff. Preparing this presentation and this staff report. And, you know, we really don't have much more to add. This is part of a rebranding of the MedStars Hospital, and coupled with the closure of the Colony South Hotel, we think it's very important to create more visibility for the hospital, and especially visibility that is safer from Branch Avenue, which, as we know, is a pretty busy arterial. So with that, I want to say we agree with staff's recommendation and wish that the board would adopt it. And we are more than happy to answer any questions you or the other members might have. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Foreman. Appreciate it. I'm going to see if the board has any questions, but I know you said Ms. Ray and Mr. Applegate are here. If there are any questions, I'd like to offer them the opportunity if they so wish to add anything. Ms. Ray, good to have you. Is there anything you care to add at this point?
I just thank you so much for your consideration today. We're very grateful to the staff also for their wonderful review. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. And Mr. Applegate?
Madam Chair, no remarks to add. I think the staff did a very nice job in putting the presentation together, and it addresses all the necessary points of information.
Thank you so very much. With that, we'll entertain a motion.
Madam Chair, move that we adopt the findings of staff and approve BSDS-715 with no conditions.
Second.
We have a motion by Commissioner Washington, seconded by Madam Vice Chair. Under discussion, it's rare when you have an approval with no conditions, so seize the day. Okay. So we have a motion and a second. Madam Vice Chair?
Well, some of us have not been out of our houses for a very long time. I had no idea Colony South Hotel was closed. I vote aye.
Okay. Well, but that's a good because you're staying in. Okay. So Commissioner Washington?
I vote aye and also associate myself with Madam Vice Chair of Vermont. So that was new news for me as well.
There we go. Okay. Commissioner Dorner?
Vote aye.
And Commissioner Giraldo?
I was aware, but I vote aye.
Okay. So the ayes have it 5-0. Thank you very much and have a good day. Good to see you.
Thank you all so much.
Thank you. All right, the next, the final item on our agenda is item 7, which is the Infrastructure Specific Design Plan 1603-01 National Capital Business Park. So it is an SDP for infrastructure only. I'm going to check to see that we have everybody. Ms. Nguyen, there you are. We see you. Mr. Zhang, do we have Mr. Zhang as well?
Yes, ma'am. I'm here to answer any question after Ms. Nguyen's presentation. Thank you.
Okay. And then I see Mr. Antonetti. Okay. Good to see you. Okay. Nice tie. Okay. Mr. Burton, are you on?
Madam Chair, I'm present.
Thank you. Mr. Jackson, are you on? Michael Jackson?
Yes, I am, Madam Chair.
Wonderful. Now, you know, I know Shipley Horn let you sign up everybody. Mr. Horn, are you on?
I'm still here.
Okay, there we go. Okay. Mr. Ferrante, are you on?
Present, Madam Chair.
Okay. R. Colfax Schnorf Jr.?
Yes, here I am, Madam Chair.
Did I pronounce it correctly?
Yes, very good. Thank you. But I should go by Cole. Yeah.
Okay, Cole. Okay, well, okay. All right, thank you. Mr. Lenhart.
Present.
Mr. Klobasko.
Present, Madam Chair.
Mr. Vizzi.
Good morning, Madam Chair.
Good morning, Mr. Vizzi. Joe DeMarco.
Present, Madam Chair.
I like that enthusiasm, Mr. Vizzi. Okay, we also have with us applicants exhibit number 1, which was submitted proposed revised condition. And finally, I'm checking one more person. Mr. Burke, are you on? Thomas Burke, are you not on? See? Okay, I was told he would be on, but that's okay. We'll save my comments for Mr. Burke soon. Okay. With that, Ms. Nguyen, we're ready for you.
Good morning, Madam Chair and members of the Planning Board. For the record, I am Rachel Nguyen with the Urban Design Section. The item before you is item 7, Specific Design Plan SDP-1603-01 for National Capital Business Park Infrastructure. This application proposes limited site improvements for the development of infrastructure, which supports the future development of the site. The applicant has submitted revised conditions into the record and staff is in full agreement. Next slide, please. The subject property is in Planning Area 74A in Council District 4. Next slide, please. Outlined in red, the 442.3-acre site is located on the north side of Leland Road, approximately a half mile from the intersection of Leland Road and US 301 Robert Crane Highway. Next slide, please. The subject area of this application is in the residential suburban development zone, and the overall site includes areas in the light industrial and residential agricultural zones. Prince George's County Council Bill CB-22-2020 was adopted on July 14, 2020 to allow uses in the employment and institutional area zone on land in the RS zone pursuant to eligibility criteria in section 27-515B. It is anticipated that the majority of the site will be warehouse uses. The site is bounded to the north by undeveloped properties in the reserved open space and open space zones, to the west by a CSX railroad and the Collington Branch Stream Valley, Beyond is undeveloped land and developed properties in the residential low development, residential agricultural, and open space zones. To the south is Leland Road, and Beyond is a residential subdivision in the residential suburban development zone and undeveloped property in the residential agricultural zone. To the east is the Collington Center, an existing employment center in the employment and institutional area and light industrial zones. Next slide, please. This aerial image shows the site is wooded and undeveloped land. Next slide, please. As shown on this topographic map, the site includes varied and irregular slopes and wetland areas on the west side of the site. Next slide, please. The subject property is located on the north side of Leland Road, shown in light blue, which is a master plan major collector roadway. The property is west of US 301 Robert Crane Highway, a master planned freeway shown in orange. Just to mention here, as it's visible on the middle right side of this slide, the intersection of Queens Court and Robert Crane Highway will include a median break and signalization of the traffic intersection as part of this proposal in coordination with the Maryland State Highway Administration. An industrial road, I-300, shown in brown, is planned as an extension of Prince George's Boulevard to Leland Road through the subject site, although recent recommendations by the District Council have indicated that this extension road may be eliminated in future. Next slide, please. The proposal includes a street network, sidewalks, utilities, grading, stormwater management areas, retaining walls, and directional signage that will serve the 426-acre RS-zoned portion of the property. As previously approved by CDP-0505-01 on April 29, 2021, and PPS-4-20032 on September 9, 2021, vehicular access to the subject site is provided by an extension of Queens Court, which is the east-west road at the center of this slide, which runs through the adjacent Collington Center and intersects with Robert Crane Highway, as previously mentioned. The extension of Queens Court intersects with an internal spine road, which is oriented north-south with cul-de-sacs on both ends. The proposed development will be located on both sides of the spine road and the Queens Court extension and includes conceptual building and parking envelopes and on-site stormwater management facilities. The project has been designed to be compact to minimize impacts to environmental features. A 20-acre public park adjacent to the Collington Branch Stream Valley is shown north of Leland Road at the far left corner of this slide. Next slide, please. This slide shows the locations of sidewalks shown in green and the proposed 10-foot shared-use trails shown in light blue and light purple. The paths shown in dark purple are conceptual pedestrian connections from sidewalks to conceptual building envelopes. This slide shows the locations for directional signage and sharrows, which are the dark green signage symbols. Highlighted in red on the left side of this plan is the proposed 20-acre public park. Next slide, please. This illustrative plan shows the conceptual design for the park at the west of the site, including the two shared use trails. The conceptual design shows sports fields, a tot lot, a comfort station, and parking area, and the design is in progress in coordination with the Department of Parks and Recreation. The final design will be part of a future application. Next slide, please. This slide shows the street tree layout and street lighting, which provides adequate vehicular and pedestrian scale lighting. The plans show general conformance with landscape manual requirements, and a condition has been included to require the applicant to provide schedules on the drawings to demonstrate conformance. Next slide, please. The proposal includes one monument sign with tenant identification and two directional signs. Staff has recommended the applicant provide sign area calculations on the plans and otherwise found the proposed signage acceptable. Next slide, please. This application includes a variance request for the removal of 5 specimen trees, 2 of which are located off-site, and as such, staff has recommended denial of those 2 removals. The remaining 3 specimen tree removals were found to be acceptable. Next slide, please. The next slides will show the primary management area PMA impacts included in this proposal. The proposed PMA impacts are considered necessary for the development and are discussed in detail on pages 22 to 25 of the staff report. Next slide, please. Impact A, shown in gray, for a proposed stormwater management outfall increases impact 3 of the PPS by 0.06 acres. This plan has obtained preliminary approval from both the Department of Permitting, Inspections, and Enforcement, DPI, and the Soil Conservation District, SCD. Next slide, please. This impact for a proposed sanitary sewer connection slightly adjusts the alignment of impact 4 of the PPS. This plan has obtained preliminary approval from the Washington Suburban Sanitary Commission, WSSC. Next slide, please. This impact for a proposed road crossing of the extension of Queens Court reduces impact 2 of the PPS by 0.49 acres and has obtained preliminary approval from DPI and SCD. Next slide, please. This impact for a proposed sanitary sewer connection increases impact 5 of the PPS by 0.01 acres. The utility layout has obtained preliminary approval from WSSC. Next slide, please. Impact E includes three areas. Areas 1 and 2 are new impacts located on the left and top right of the slide and are for proposed stormwater management outfalls. Both areas have obtained preliminary approval from DPI and SCD. Area 3 at the bottom right of the slide slightly adjusts the alignment of Impact 9 of the PPS, and this utility layout has obtained preliminary approval from WSSC. Next slide, please. With that, the urban design section recommends that the Planning Board adopt the findings and conditions of the technical staff report and approve specific design plan SDP-1603-01 for National Capital Business Park Infrastructure and Tree Conservation Plan TCP-2-026-2021-01, subject to the modification of two conditions as provided by applicant Exhibit 1. This concludes staff's presentation.
Thank you. Let's see if the board has any questions of you, Madam Vice Chair.
No questions, thank you.
Commissioner Washington?
No questions, thank you.
Commissioner Dorner?
No questions, thank you.
And Commissioner Giraldo?
No questions, Madam Chair.
Okay, with that, we can turn to you, Mr. Antonetti.
Good morning, Madam Chair, members of the Planning Board. For the record, my name is Robert Antonetti. It's a law firm of Shipley and Horn. And I'm here today with my partner, Arthur J. Horn, and Mr. John Ferrante, our senior land planner. And we are pleased to represent the applicant for this specific design plan for infrastructure only. Today with me, we also have Mr. Cole Schnorf, applicant representative, Mr. Chris Rizzi, and Joe DeMarco from Bowler, civil engineers for the project, and landscape architects. Mr. Mike Lenhart, our traffic engineer, and Mr. Michael Klobasko, our environmental consultant from WSSI. They are here to answer any questions that may come up that I can't address throughout this hearing. I would like to thank staff, Ms. Nguyen and Mr. Zhang, for their communication, coordination, and thorough review of this case. It's always a pleasure to work with them, and this is no exception. As you heard, this is for infrastructure only. The staff report goes over the history of this project as well as the presentation today. It does have a long entitlement history. It's for the National Capital Business Park, which you've become familiar with. It has a basic plan approval. It has a comprehensive design plan approval and a preliminary plan, which was approved pretty much in the late fall of 2021. The project has is planned to be a modern employment park adjacent to the Collington Center. It'll include up to 3.5 million square feet of employment uses, such as warehouse and distribution, office, light industrial manufacturing, and or industrial uses, or institutional uses, excuse me. All the proposed roads for this project will connect to the existing Collington Center to the north. There will be no connection to Leland Road, and that's a big change from the original entitlements for this project many years ago, the Willowbrook Residential Project. All vehicular traffic related to the employment park, directly to the employment park, will go through the roads in the Collington Center and onto 301. There will also be the 20-acre public park. The exhibit that you saw on the slideshow is actually an early concept. That concept has now evolved in part due to discussions with both Department of Parks and Recreation and the local community, where we had a kind of a joint meeting where we talked about the needs of the neighborhood. And it looks like we're transitioning more or less from a ball field focused park to one that has a dog park, a cricket field, a pavilion, trails, parking lot, the bathroom facilities. Something a little different programmatically, but something that would fill kind of a gap that doesn't currently exist within the sector. So it'll be a very interesting park moving forward, and we look forward to finalizing that design and having that reflect appropriately through an application with the commission. So there are two master plan shared use trails that were shown on the bike and pedestrian exhibit. This park, this National Capital Business Park, moving forward, will be an incredible job creator. We'll create thousands of new jobs in Prince George's County. It will be an incredible boom to the commercial tax base for the county. Upon a full build out, it's estimated to have an aggregate assessed value of over $500 million. It will generate over $20 million in annual tax revenue. And it will lead to additional improvements to 301 utilizing this US 301 CIP. It'll likely be in physical improvements in excess of $7 million based on the contribution and impact of this project on its pro rata impact, to the US 301 CIP. This application, again, is for grading, general landscaping, stormwater management facilities, streets, and the signage that you saw. The application does meet all applicable conditions from prior approvals. And all pertinent sections of the zoning ordinance for approval of a specific design plan. We do agree with the recommendations of the staff, with the exception of a few very minor revisions, which staff and Madam Chair, you identified, I believe is marked as applicants exhibit one. And if appropriate, I could go through that very briefly.
It is, and it's not much, but you can go ahead, Mr. Antonetti.
Yes, Madam Chair, thank you. So on applicants exhibit one, it's condition 1D4. Actually, four remains. I apologize. I got a little ambitious with my strike through. The number four remains, but it would state, add a note to the plan indicating that the Leland Road Trail shall be continuous and will be adjusted to accommodate the ultimate driveway entrance location to the park. Just to show a continuity of that master plan shared use trail. We have no issue with that change, and I believe staff is in support of that as well. Secondly, condition 2Q, just add the word application and strike out the word SDP. This has to do with the park facilities and how they'll be reflected in terms of any variance requests for removal of specimen trees. It's all timing. It depends on whether I believe the commission owns the land through dedication or we still own the land as the applicant, as to whether or not it would be an SDP or a mandatory referral. So we just reference application as opposed to a specific application type that might trigger that variance request. So with those changes, we are, again, support of the staff recommendation. We respectfully urge the planning board to approve SDP 160301 as modified by applicants exhibit one. And we do thank you for your consideration and support of this important project. And with that, we're here to answer any questions that you may have, and we thank you for your time today.
Thank you, Mr. Antonetti. I'm going to see if the board has any questions of you before I go back to Ms. Gwynn to see if she has any comments, and then we have a number of people signed up, but most of them are probably for questions. Okay. So Madam Vice Chair, any questions?
No questions.
Thank you. Okay. Commissioner Washington.
No questions. Thank you.
And Commissioner Dorner.
No questions. Thank you.
And Commissioner Geraldo.
No questions, Madam Chair.
Thank you. Although I will say this, Mr. Antonetti, I see Commissioner Geraldo smiling big time. So I'm sure he'll get to that. Okay. All right, so Ms. Gwynn, is there anything you care to add at this point before I call on others?
Nope. Thank you. I do want to thank the applicant for working with us so closely, and we're here for any questions as well.
Okay. Thank you. So, and then Mr. Antonetti, all of the folks signed up there are just for questions only?
Correct, Madam Chair. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. So, and then I guess Mr. Burton and transportation and Mr. Jackson, you have no comments?
I have no comment, Madam Chair. This is Glenn Burton.
Thank you, Mr. Burton.
The record, this is Michael Jackson. I have no comments with the transportation planning section.
Thank you. And I'm not sure if Mr. Burke got on or not. Can you check, Thomas? No. Okay, thank you. With that, we're ready for a motion.
Madam Chair, I move that we adopt the findings of staff and approve SDP-1603-01 and TCP-2-026-2021-01 to include a variance for the removal of three specimen trees, along with the associated conditions as outlined in staff's report and as further modified by applicant exhibit number one.
Thank you. And you said findings too, right? Okay.
Yes, I did. I'm sorry.
Okay. Thank you. We have a motion by Commissioner Washington, seconded by Vice Chair Bailey. I thought surely Commissioner Commissioner Geraldo would have been on that one. So we have a motion by Commissioner Washington, seconded by Madam Vice Chair. Madam Vice Chair, is there any discussion?
I just defer to the sororities today.
Madam Vice Chair.
Vote aye.
Commissioner Washington.
Vote aye.
Commissioner Dorner.
Vote aye.
And Commissioner Geraldo.
Vote aye, Madam Chair. Thank you.
Okay, the ayes have it 5-0. With that, so good to see you. Happy New Year, Mr. Antonetti, and good to see you. So with that, Mr. Hunt, is there, this is in addition to Martin Luther King's question, what are you doing for others? My next question for today is there any additional business to come before the planning board today?
There are no additional business items before the board today, Madam Chair.
This is a good one. Planning board is adjourned. We thank you very much. Please celebrate Reverend Martin Luther King Day. It's also a day of service. So do something for others. The world does not revolve around us as individuals. Do something for the greater good. Planning board is adjourned. Have a good day.
Thank you.